Hello everyone, you're welcome to La Dress Special. This is big exclusive. Today we'll be unmasking the man behind the plane. Alan Ifechukwu Onyema. He is the chairman chief executive of West Africa's biggest airline, Epis Airlines. Hello, Alan. You're welcome to Adachi Chenu's La Dress. First of all, please do accept our condolences on the demise of your father.
Yes, sir. Rest in perfect peace.
Amen.
I know that your father must have played a huge role in molding the man you are today.
Of course. I was very close to my father. And everybody or anybody who knows me knows that I'm very, very close to my dad. When it happened and when people heard it, the first thing most people were saying was,
how would Alan take this? Even my children also were feeling for me. And my wife was feeling for me. Even my siblings were scared for me because they knew I was very, very close to my dad. My dad was my best friend, an honest man, a disciplinarian to the core. My father abhorred dishonesty, and my father loved mankind. Some of the things you see me doing are acquired from him. He was a fair-minded person, never wanted to hurt anyone, but abhorred dishonesty with anything he could muster. So I took that from him. My father is like an activist. I'm an activist myself. My father supported most of the things I did growing up, and most of the things I'm doing even now. During my school days, I could rise up against the school for one thing or the other. My father would take sides with me. The first thing he would ask is, what happened? And I would like say, well, some people wanted to cheat. And I said no. And they went after me, and I went after them too. And so my father would say, there you are. This child deserves every support for him to grow up this way. Even in my hometown, in those days, I would go home for holidays in the East. And I became a member of my town student union body in those days at the age of 12. I was in class 3. There were others in the university. But I discovered that so many things were not going right. I also felt that there was some level of corruption in the way the student union accounts were being run. I also felt that there was injustice to some sections of the town, that some parts of the town were being marginalized in the scheme of things. And I led a revolt at the age of 13. I led a revolt, and believe me, even people, students from universities signed on. I drew up a speech. It was a speech I drew up to overthrow the government of the student body. And I was going from hamlet to hamlet, house to house, trekking, getting people to sign. And parents didn't understand what was giving this little boy impetus. And people just naturally followed me. And on the day of the student union body convention, I had already gathered a lot of people, thousands of them, supporting me. And we made sure we overthrew the student union government that same day. You know, so I've been an activist. I'm afraid of nothing. I'm only afraid of God. And I know God loves me. And God is in everything I do. God uses me to do things. I can just dream about anything, and I tell God I want to do it, and it happens.
Okay, that's the why you came about this airline. You just dream of owning an airline, and then it happened.
You see, in 2007, actually, I was never involved in aviation before. My very first stint with aviation was in 1998. My real estate business was booming. I was one of those people who in those days used to, you know, get fallow lands, develop them into layouts and real estate and start selling and other kind of things. So I had good business in the 90s. My real estate business was really booming. So some people knew I had got money, and they came to me and said, we need to float a cargo airline. Now one cargo plane could give us all the millions we you know, get. So there were 9 of us for one plane. I brought my money to the table. They didn't bring their own money. It took me about 9 months to get my money. And I swore then I would never ever do partnership in this country. I didn't know anything about aviation. I just wanted to contribute to be a part owner of whatever they were going to do. They would manage it. Some of them were pilots and people in aviation. I didn't know anything about aviation. That was then, 1998. It was until 2007. I was looking for ways of creating jobs, because I was doing a lot of philanthropy, and I would give people money and they would come back and ask for more. Some people would meet me and say, oh, I want to do business, give me money, I need this and that, and I'll give them, and they will come back, tell me some stories just to get more. And my father didn't like that. My father felt a lot of people were feeding on my kindness and calling me a fool. So my father was looking for ways of making, you know, bringing permanent changes in people's lives. He now called me an advice that he was tired of people thinking that you are stupid. They'll take money from you and give you the nose and walk away and come again. Look for something you could do that could touch a lot of lives. Me too, I was looking for something like that. That was actually my promise to God. Bless me and I'll use whatever you give me to touch lives of indigenous people. The life of giving is something that is ingrained in me and even my wife. So it was not long, somebody now advised me to go into aviation. That one Boeing 737 will give 1,000 people jobs. I naively believed that, and I began to pursue that ambition to float an airline in order to give people jobs. That was how I started in 2007. So I started nurturing, I started educating myself. I started studying why did Nigerian airlines fail. I started, you know, schooling myself. Before I knew it, I became passionate about it all. So it was not until, I think about 2010 or thereabout, I got APIS Incorporated. I named it APIS because I'm in peace building. I've always been peace building all my life, right from childhood. So I have other businesses that are peace this, peace that. So when I decided to float the airline, I named it APIS. So that was how it started. I bought my first aircraft in 2013. Actually, when I got my air transport license, I got engineer Bolahun Abaton as my consultant to help me in getting the AOC that will eventually allow me to fly as an airline. The air transport license does not allow you to fly as an airline, but you need to get it first before any other thing. And I told him what I wanted. So we went searching for planes. The first plane we bought was Etonian, very powerful aircraft. And it was the first plane we bought. So that was in London. Then we traveled to Germany, to the factory where they manufactured this. And we bought another one. Another Donian 328 jet. Then we traveled to the United States. We bought another one. Another Donian 328 jet. Then we now came back to London. And I said, now, well, that means these three jets could give us 3,000 jobs. Balaam laughed. Balaam laughed. In fairness to Balaam, he taught me most things I knew. I respect him. I love him. He taught me most things I know in aviation today. He brought me up. He told me all he taught me the basics. You know, as at that time, you were floating an airline, you already started buying planes. I didn't know what cycles meant.
It seems, oh, this plane has done 20 cycles. I didn't know what that meant. Cycles means landing. The number of landings.
You only focus on the amount of people you're going to...
Yes! I was naive. So Balaam and I laughed and said, no, these three planes, you don't even need more than four people to market it for you. Now, all you need to employ some fine chaps, smart chaps, they'll be marketing charter. You'll be making money. In those days, charter was booming. So he told me that we could make as much as even $50,000 daily on one aircraft. So he calculated that the money was so much. However, I wore a long face. I was very, very angry. And Balaam now said, Chief, what's the problem? I said, but this is not what I wanted. He couldn't believe it. He's alive. He's a man I respect so much. He could tell you this. I said, but this is not what I want. So I got angry in London. We got back from Texas to London on our way to Nigeria. I made food for both of us to eat. At times I like trying myself, cooking. At times I could start making stew and it end up being soup. And you drop your rice and eat ever. You know, that kind of thing. So I used to cook for myself and Bolano. We were having a nice time. So, but that day we quarreled. I was very, very, very angry because I thought this was it. In fact, my mood fouled the atmosphere in my living room in London. That was why APs had three Dunia jets in the beginning. I'm not looking for money. I just want to give people jobs. But what you've just told me now is that these three planes will make me richer. But how about the people I want to give jobs? He said, no, you don't need people on this. That means you want a full-blown airline, commercial, scheduled flight operations. That's what you want. I said, yes, that's what I want. He said, my dear, it's a very, very risky business. It's capital intensive. It does not give you returns. In fact, if you are very, very prudent, and if you manage it very well, then, of course, 7-8 years down the line, you start getting maybe returns, maybe very marginal, maybe 1%. That's what he told me. And I said, does it mean I will lose everything I've got? He said, no, if it is well managed, your capital will still be there, but no gain. And it's very risky. Any little thing, you could lose everything. I said, the God I serve will not allow me to lose anything. Because the intentions behind me doing this is to create jobs. Because somebody told me, he said, yes, airline business, it can create massive employment, instant massive employment. But the airline business will favor your staff, the employees. It will favor the government that collects taxes from you. It will favor your banks that will get the whatever turnover or inflows into their banks. The owner ends up being the one suffering. I said, well, God will take care of me. I want to... You see, look at this country. All around you is poverty. So you need to do something to help the indigent. Why do we have insecurity? It's because a lot of people don't have means of livelihood. If they have a place to go to every morning, they won't do bombing, they won't do kidnapping, they won't do armed robbery. Though some people, no matter how what you give them, but at least the number of people that go into such vices will be reduced drastically. So I decided, in my way of paying God back, this is the only way I can serve God. I'm not an imam, I'm not a pastor. This is the only way I think I can serve my God. And my wife agreed with me that we should do it. Bola now said, in that case, we have to go and look for Boeing or Airbus. So I said, I went online. And then I called the man we bought one of the Dunia jets from in America. He said, okay, I should come over. Instead of going back to Nigeria, we flew back to the United States. We went to Texas. His name is Douglas Jaffe. He's alive. He's one of the biggest, if not the world's biggest dealers, vendors in aircraft. He sells in hundreds. So we went to him and I said, I want to buy 737. He said, why do you want 737? I said, I want to float a scheduled airline operation. He said, why do you want to do that? It's risky. I said, I want to do it. He said, why? I said, because he was already looking for more donor jets for us.
Okay.
I said, because I want to create jobs in my country. Then he shifted from his seat. You want to create jobs in your country? I said, yes, I was convinced that scheduled airline operations do great jobs. And that is why I want to go into it. He said, is that all? You know, this is a risky business. I said, yes, I know. But at the same time, if you manage it very well, you'll not lose your money and you'll keep on creating jobs. He couldn't believe. He stood up from his seat and looked at me and shook hands with me and said, what kind of aircraft do you want? I said, I want 737-800-800. He said, where are you flying to? Tell me, list all your routes. I started writing, Lagos, Maiduguri, Lagos, Yola, Lagos, Sokoto, Lagos, Owerri, Lagos, Enugu, Lagos, Benin, Lagos, Port Harcourt. I started writing all the Nigerian. Then he plotted them on a graph and showed it to us on a screen. I said, my dear, all you've told me, none is, most of them, 95% of them are 40 minutes flights, 50 minutes flights, 1 hour flights. The longest was
Maiduguri,
about 1 hour, 30 minutes. Then he said, you don't need a 737-800. So I looked at it, I refused. He said, look, I'm not going to deal with you. I know the motive behind your setting up this airline is to help your people, and I'm here to help you. I'm here to advise you rightly. So he said, look, with this, you start, nobody knows you. You're going to start small. Just start that way. When he started withdrawing the planes, the major U.S. airline, I don't want to name them because of non-disclosure, didn't want to release up to seven. They released four. That was why I started operations with four Boeing 737-500 and three Dornier 328 jets. And the -500s came with 114 seats, 12 business class seats, and 102 economy. After a year, I sold two of the Dornier jets.
Okay.
And kept only one seat. The other one is a private jet that we use for charters and other.
Okay, you also do charter?
Yeah, we do charter. We have an executive jet. The other two, we sold the other two to a British airline. I'm sure for a major British airline to come here to buy our planes, I don't think they've never done that before. It shows the trust the international community has has for air peace, about maintenance and everything.
How many aircrafts do you have now?
Because we've given away these other two. We have 25, that's 25 flying. Then of course we have 10 737 MAX on order. Then we have the recent one, the E2195.
Mm-hmm.
The 30 jets we went after.
I know you love Boeing. With recent two tragedies involving Boeing 737 MAX, what's going to happen to the orders you placed recently? Are you sticking with those orders or are you canceling them?
Well, I cannot say yes, but neither can I say no at this juncture.
Okay.
Boeing and the authorities, they've not come up with the reports of their investigations. Everybody is waiting for the reports of the investigation. And until that happens, you cannot cancel your order now for what happened elsewhere. Without in aviation, is about the investigation must come through first before you take such decisions. We are not in a hurry. After all, we are supposed to receive our orders in 2023-24.
Okay,
that's some 4 or 5 years time, so it's still a long shot. Time is not right for that kind of decision, but in whatever we do, we must carry the Nigerian flying public along.
That's lovely. The first time your first 777 came in, and you told me that it's for your international worldwide destination that will be starting very soon, because it's been a long time coming now. When is it going to start? Do you have a date for it now?
First and foremost, I want to say that all my life I've been trying to do things to help my country. and nobody should doubt me. I'm not blowing my trumpet, I'm just being modest. I'm a good example of, think of what you can do for your nation, and not what your nation can do for you. You all knew what I did in the Niger Delta. How I started using my own funds to attack the incidents of violence in the Niger Delta from 2004 till the thing culminated into amnesty. When I was doing that, people didn't ask where I got my money from. I was using my own funds to be picking those boys, training and transforming them, brought the entire faculty of the Center for Nonviolence and Peace Development of the University of Rhode Island in America down to Nigeria with my funds for the sake of my country. Nobody is celebrating me. Tell me any Nigerian, dead or alive, who did that. I did that when the military and the use of force couldn't work in the Delta region. I did that. I've traversed the length and breadth of this country. All the northern emirs, the first-class emirs in the north, in the old, they all knew me. Because I believe in this nation called Nigeria. I'm passionate about Nigeria. I'm passionate about our oneness. I believe in the huge diversity God has given us as a nation. 378 ethnic nationalities. That is a huge source for progress and strength. Unfortunately, Nigerians are not harnessing that God's given gift. And it hurts me. So I'm always out there to look for what I could do for my nation. It's not only in the Niger Delta, in the north, in the east, everywhere, even here in the west. I try to do things to touch lives, to promote broad nationalism in Nigeria as against ethnic nationalism or religious nationalism. So between 2004 and 2008 to 9 to 10, I did things to help my country nobody ever did. When I was picking the militants and training and transforming them, the international community took notice of me. The Nigerian government only took notice. I think during Obasanjo's regime, they took notice. The State Security Service were following me all over the place. They would show up here and there, trying to know what I was actually doing with these guys. The United States Consulate in Nigeria came and saw for themselves, and they participated one way or the other. All the oil companies, beginning with Shell, started it up, bankrolling me. But then I had spent millions, hundreds of millions, of my own funds for the sake of my country. So when I say I floated a piece to create jobs, people shouldn't doubt me because it hurts. They shouldn't doubt me. If I wanted to make money, I would have obeyed Engineer Golan Abaton, and I could have started with only the Donia Jets. I employed only 3 people or 4 people and be making my thousands of dollars daily. But that was not the thing for me in there. I just wanted to touch lives. And the way APC is run, the staff will tell you that truly, truly, you know. Thursdays I could come out there and ask 200 people, bring your CVs. I don't know them. They come from the far north, far east, west, everywhere. And I employ. But now we are getting over bloated, so we stopped, but we're still going to start again. So the issue of acquiring 777, when we started, I have a business plan that on my 4th year, I will start acquiring wide-body planes. By our 5th year, or after 4th year, we should start doing international operations. And we lived up to our business plan. I started doing the West Coast since 2017. That's about 3 years into our operations. We started the West Coast, about 5 countries now. Now we want to start the international operations because I saw a huge gap. No Nigerian airline is doing international. Most Nigerian airlines fell by the wayside. And I have to give you the reasons why. A lot of people say, oh, governance structure. Nigerians are aware, oh, it's the governance structure of these airlines. That's why the airlines are not doing well. Nobody is giving the Nigerian airline any credit. People should remember that these businessmen who went into aviation must have been successful in other endeavors. Why did they succeed in these other endeavors and failed in aviation? I will enumerate how the circumstance is responsible for the failure of airlines in Nigeria. One is the ownership of these airlines. Aviation is a small world. Any little
misdemeanor from you, the world hears it. The annoying thing is that it rubs off very badly on all of us. They say, oh, Nigerians are like this, Nigerians are like that. Secondly, the operating environment in Nigeria is very harsh. Government policies not friendly to the growth of aviation in Nigeria. I'm not talking about this present government. This thing has always been there. The cost of running the operations in Nigeria is so high. We produce crude oil in Nigeria, yet our aviation fuel costs more than the people in the US and other places. So in Nigeria, you can't even plan. In aviation parlance, it is said that fuel takes about 40% of your cost of operations. I disagree. In Nigeria, it's a different ball game. In Nigeria, it takes about maybe 70%, because you may buy fuel in the morning, 250 naira to a liter. By afternoon, they will tell you it's now 300. By dusk, in the evening, they will tell you it has gone back to 350. It is very expensive to run.
Not stable.
Not stable. Now, how about spare parts? If you're running an airline in America, if your aircraft is snagged, if your aircraft goes tech, very easy to get spare parts immediately. In Nigeria, if your aircraft goes AOG, that's goes tech, and you don't have that particular spare in your stores, that aircraft is grounded for several other days. It comes back, you have to order. You know the travel times from US or from the West. By the time it gets to Nigeria, customs may not understand what AOG means. AOG all over the world is treated with dispatch immediately. Aircraft is treated like a human being. In Nigeria, it's a different case. So customs might keep your space there for another 2 weeks.
But you had meetings with them too.
Yeah, we've been complaining, but they've started changing. They've started changing for good. I mean, give it to them.
Okay.
Now they release our parts as they come. There's an improvement, but there's room for also more improvement. International aeropolitics is another one. Nigerian airlines are struggling to survive under the weight of deliberate attempts to make sure they don't come up. These attempts are made both from within and without. That is why you don't have any airline doing well in Nigeria. The cost of flight is so much. And that is also making us to lose jobs. Nigerian airlines could have created for their citizens, the foreign airlines. Nigerian route is the most profitable to most of these foreign airlines. All the foreign airlines in this world, the Nigerian Lagos route is their most profitable route. From Lagos to London, 6 hours flight. You pay more than somebody traveling from Johannesburg, 9 hours to London. And full load at all times. So all the foreign airlines are having a feast on Nigeria, and they will never want a Nigerian airline to succeed. What of insurance? The outside world, they have a way of blacklisting, a way of, you know, stigmatizing Nigeria. They say Nigeria is so unsafe. Because of that, your insurance is like this. It's very huge. What I use in insuring one plane is what in the developed world, they use insuring about 4 planes.
Okay.
So how do you want Nigerian airlines to break even? And at the same time, the law in Nigeria says that you must go through a Nigerian company, a Nigerian insurance company. That's the Nikon law. You must go through a Nigerian insurance company. And all the insurance companies in Nigeria put together cannot even insure one plane alone. They cannot afford to insure one plane alone. Yet, you must go through a Nigerian insurance company. So they will be the ones to now access the London market for you.
Okay.
Because of that middle sumness, the thing is increasing. There's an insurance company. When my spare parts stores at the airport was gutted in fire 3 years ago, as I speak to you, I had to bring in a senior advocate of Nigeria to take them to court. They don't pay claims.
The Nigerian side. Okay.
Because I went through them, they were the ones who are supposed to sort you out. They will start telling you stories. So, God forbid, assuming something happened, something greater, happened? What could have been the fate of the airline and the passengers? So we have to do another thing. People don't know what it takes us to carry them from point to point in this country. So in APIS, we decided to change all that. Not because we want to make money. All I care for is the lives of the thousands of people that APIS have given means of livelihood in the last 4 years of our operations. And that is what gladdens my heart. They are not afraid of me anywhere. They come around me, they clog around me. They know I love them. They know APIS is for them. And the staff of APIS are protecting APIS with everything they've got. That does not mean we don't have some bad eggs within. You must have some Judases when you have 12 people. But APIS is for them. Everything we make is in there. Banks are running, falling all over themselves to do business with APIS because of my integrity and integrity of the airline. We borrow money, we pay. All the planes we didn't buy with our own cash. Money we are borrowed, funds we are taking from banks. And we created sinking funds for them, so no fears for them. They were all getting their money. Sometimes, even before the expiration of the tenure. Most times, not sometimes, most times. So this is the reason for our growth. The banks are there. Even the recent order of 30E2195 Embraer jets is being supported by foreign financial institutions that believe in APIS. So APIS is laundering the image of this country positively. And we deserve to be supported by everyone, both the government of Nigeria and the people of Nigeria. If they support APIS today, it will rub off on other airlines very soon. Because the world is taking notice of APIS and are saying, oh, this is a Nigerian airline, they have integrity. That's why foreign financial institutions are involved in our E2 projects, because they believe. So if APIS could come out of Nigeria, that means there are some other good people in Nigeria. The world, they don't believe that there's anything good in Nigeria. Yeah. So all of a sudden, the Nigerian airline is getting it right. And the world, every day we receive requests. Come and discuss with us.
This Embraer order, where will you be deploying them when they finally arrive? And when are they actually going to be in the country?
The good thing is that the Nigerians will start experiencing the beauty of these Embraer jets next year. From May next year. So close. Very powerful aircraft. It has a steep approach capability. That means as we have risings all over the place here, the aircraft can come and do some kind of nose diving, take off in a very short runway, even though it's a big plane. It's as big as the Boeing
777. Wow.
It's not the small Embraer like the one we use in Green Asaban and some other small airports. So, it's a big plane, single configuration of 146 seats, dual configuration, that is business class and the economy, of 124. 12 business class seats and 112 economy seats. So it's a big aircraft. It has endurance that could take it to the south of Spain, or the south of Italy, or the south of France. But mostly we are going to deploy them in the domestic environment and the regional also. And the aircraft is customer passenger friendly. There's nothing like sitting in the middle. It's two aside. It's either you're sitting on the aisle or you're sitting by the window. And the width of the seat is big. So even when you are in the economy, you feel as if you are in a business class. And the business class seats are staggered, like the international wide body planes. You know, staggered, not sitting with each other like this.
Okay.
Everyone is in front, the other one is behind, you know, like this. Very beautiful, modern aircraft, very safe. We are very happy we are going to be the launch customers in Africa.
Yeah,
and it's something to be grateful to God for.
I put sharing within the airline now.
Part of the reasons why most Nigerian airlines didn't succeed abroad was because of code share or lack of partnership with other airlines, quality code share interlining. APIS will not do that. APIS will not go point to point only. We are going to partner with foreign airlines. So wherever destination we are going to, when we get to Dubai or Sharjah, another airline from there will take you from that point
to the other point you're going to. For example, with APs, what we are going to give Nigerians on June when we start.
Is it official?
Yeah, their favorite airline will hit the skies.
Wow.
With very beautiful planes. Any airline in the world could be proud of. So I invite Nigerians to come and fly APs. We are hitting Sharjah in United Arab Emirates. You know, Sharjah and Dubai are together there. The Sharjah airport and the Dubai airport are just about 6 minutes apart or 7 minutes apart. With beautiful airplanes that any airline under the sun will be very proud of. With experienced pilots, experienced 777 pilots who have been flying all over the world for over 20 years. On that day, if you're going to Jeddah, if you're going to Riyadh, if you're going to Mecca, if you're going to India, and not just India, if you're going to Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Ahmedabad, Pune, Chennai, about 20-something cities in India. If you're going there, and some place in Bahrain, the Gulf region, the entire Gulf region, India and some parts of Asia, Malaysia and others, when you are going to those places, buy a peace ticket, just one ticket. When we drop you in Sharjah, our partnering airline will take you from there. When you check in your luggage in Nigeria, you get the luggage either in India or wherever you're going to, seamlessly. Connection is seamless. That is what we are offering Nigerians. But beyond that, we are going to do the right pricing for Nigerians.
Okay.
We are going to make sure we bring down the cost of flying for this country, for Nigerians. Nigerians have been ripped off for so long. We are going to bring down the prices. When we start bringing down prices, Nigerians should remember that these other older airlines trying to bring down their prices now are doing it because APs
is doing that,
not because they love them. So they should show the love to APs.
Because of this competition.
It's competition now. So we are coming to save our country in the, from the hands of foreign airlines. So another thing we are going to do for Nigerians that is never done before, wherever your base is in Nigeria, and you are going to Sharjah or Dubai with APs, we pick you from there. For example, if somebody in Sokoto buys APs ticket, we pick you from Sokoto, bring you to Lagos, take your luggage, put you in an air-conditioned bus, brand new air-conditioned bus, take you to the international airport, put you on the plane and fly you out.
On whose account?
On APs account. And bring you back. On your coming back, we do the same thing back to you. So if you're flying from Calabar, from Benin, from Enugu, from Owerri, from Port Harcourt, from Abuja, or anywhere, once you buy that our ticket to where to any destination we are flying outside the country, not any destination, international destinations like India, Johannesburg, Sharjah, we pick you from wherever, get to the Lagos airport, your luggage is compartmentalized, in a different compartments, we take your luggage seamlessly, put you on your bus. We take you to the international. You don't need to tell your driver to come and wait. We do everything for you and put you on our aircraft. And you travel peacefully to United Arab Emirates. And when you get there, we are going to provide bus that will take you to the center of the city for economy passengers. For our business and first class passengers, we are going to give them chauffeur-driven limousine. Coming back to the airport, they come and pick you.
Okay, I'm bringing it back. Fine. And this service is it going to be continuous, or it's just going to be
continuous for
a while?
No, the service of chauffeur driven buses and limousines is going to be permanent. Even the one of picking you from
your point A to point B,
yes.
Until you are able to fly from Kano to Dubai,
yeah.
From Enugu to
Dubai. But for now, everyone flying us should expect to be picked from wherever you are, and we'll take you to Dubai.
Wow.
And if you're flying beyond United Arab Emirates, our partnering airlines are there to take you. You don't even touch your luggage. You don't even know where it is until you get to your final destination.
All right. I'm really very excited. Anyway, there's something I've been wanting to ask you, Alan. The first time I feel a peace, when I heard a peace, all right, in my mind, I said, waiting person will go see for this country. Which one now is a peace now, eh? So eventually, when I went to a magazine, you have an in-flight magazine, immediately I fell in love with the airline. I said, okay, this man knows it's not just an airline that wants to come and go.
Because when I started reading, I learned how important family is to you. Whatever you are today is because of your family. And that
this one is named
Alice because she's your wife.
I say, yeah. I didn't even know the name of the aircraft that I even bought it. So when I came down, I took time and started, you know, noticing the names. You go Chuku, Nena, Obina, Alice, Peggy, Ifechuku. So yeah. So how did you know come about naming your aircraft after? I don't know who those names, you know, after.
Well, they are members of my family, you see. We have vices all over the world because of breakdown of family, you know, virtues. If the family, because of the family I come from, there are certain things I will never do because I'll be so scared of disappointing members of my family. So family helped in you know, bringing me up. We are very close to my family. So when I bought the first 7 planes, I named them after my 4 children. The 4 727s were named after Nena, Chinonso, Odina, Ukuchuku. Then the other 3 jets, the junior jets, one was named Michael after my dad.
Yeah.
May his soul rest in peace. The other one after my mom, Helen. May her soul rest in peace. Then the third one was named after my wife, Alice. So, like I sold 2 of the jets, and when I bought two more 737, I replaced the names. You can see one Alice Edward to the Onyema, another one has Helen Ekusi Onyema, that's my mom.
Okay.
So, as I was buying, I bought more. My father had 6 siblings. They were 6. My uncles and my auntie. So one was Oliver Ositaduma Onyema, my father's immediate elder brother. Then one had my father, Mike Chukuka Onyema. Another one had Captain Jonathan Obiemeka Onyema. Another one had Caroline Abasere, Ne Onyema, that's the only sister.
My father had.
Another one is Isaac Onyema, another one is Matthias Onyema. Those are my uncles. The same family. So when I finished my 6 uncles, my 4 children, my father, my mother, my wife, I now entered my siblings.
Okay.
There are 9 of us.
Same parents,
9 of us. I'm the first child. We lost our mother. My mother left us at the age of 44. She was 44 when she died in 1981. At first, I didn't name any aircraft after me. So I started naming the 6 Embraer jets. I had my siblings on them. You see Udoka, you see Nkechi, you see Chinonye, Gina Omogo, Kenneth, Dimitibu, my younger brother. I have only one brother, 7 sisters, yeah. So, and I bought some more 737s named after Tina, my immediate younger sister, and all of them. So, when the 777s started coming, my wife said she would like her name on the 777. So, you can see one, Ojo Chide, her girl and name. My wife is from Kogi State.
Okay.
Ojo Chide, that's my wife's Igala name. So she has 2 planes in her name, you know,
737.
I'm sure baby when the Embraer comes, maybe my wife have another name there.
Okay.
So one of the 777s was named after my wife. And when the second 777 was coming, my wife insisted, he said it must bear my name. So my wife, as the vice chairman of the company, called on them and said, change that. Put my husband's name there. Put My wife calls me Ifechukwu. She doesn't call me Alan. She prefers telling me my native name, which I love so much.
It's beautiful name.
So she said if you put Ifechukwu there, so they put.
Okay, the first one that came.
Yeah, Ifechukwu, that was Ifechukwu. The first one, yeah.
Yes.
It was my wife that I didn't know until like the plane touched ground. I didn't know it was going to come with my name. I wanted to put one of my cousins because I finished my siblings and okay, it was remaining only Amoni. So I was surprised when I saw Ifechukwu there. And when the next one came, she put her name, she was preparing ground to put her.
She wanted to make sure that your name comes first.
When the third one came, Anguli Peggy Onyema is our last born, my youngest sibling.
How did they feel seeing their names?
Yeah, they like it. They always go to take pictures. One of my uncles, Captain Onyema, who actually I grew up with, he loved me like he was like my dad. In fact, himself and my dad is quite because of attention from me, you know, each one wanted to get more attention. He loved you so much. So his greatest wish was to have his name on one of the planes. Unfortunately, he was on his sick bed in London. He had cancer. He was on his sick bed when the aircraft amend after him arrived. So he didn't have the opportunity of seeing the airport, and that really hurt me. The one with Jonathan. It's all about family. Now I'm going to enter my cousins. when is on starting
coming?
I will enter my cousins. Yeah, like I want to name one aircraft Worry Boy.
Worry you grew up in Worry?
Yes. I attended Covent College with me. I grew up in Worry.
Wow.
And God willing, one of my hometown. Then I'll start listening to my friends.
That'd be wonderful.
Where do you see RPs in the next 5 years?
Well, in the next 5 years, RPs, by the special grace of God, will be the airline to beat in Africa. I don't see anything stopping our march towards success. If in the last 4 years we've been able to do what we're able to do now, if we continue in that direction, we should be having over 100 fleets and we'll be the airline of choice in Africa. We tend to take over the leadership of commercial airline aviation. But that is not our target. Our target is just to do the right thing, continue creating jobs for the masses of Nigerian people. The only thing we need is the support of everyone, support of government agencies, and support of government and the people of Nigeria. And we give them what they are looking for. They are international flight operations into Sharjah, United Arab Emirates. And we are going to give them a kind of service they've never had before. Like I said, we are going to engender price war. In the sense that when we start giving Nigerians the right pricing, all these foreign airlines have been ripping them off over the years. We come down from their rooftop of pricing. And they will start respecting Nigerians and treating them like human beings. Because of the competition, they know, all these airlines, they know that APC is a serious airline, you know. So it's not going to be the same way they've been carrying on in the past. That I can promise you. We know what they're going to do. The international aeropolitics is very dirty. Therefore, I call on our government to help us to play it. Some countries didn't respond to our mails. We send them Nigerian government's approval. It took them 3 years to respond to our mail because they didn't want any Nigerian airline to come to their country. They want to reserve it for the airlines coming from their own country. That is why I'm against the proliferation of designations for foreign airlines into Nigeria. It's hurting the economy of this country to no end.
The domestic carriers too.
It is hurting the domestic carriers. It is hurting indigenous jobs. It is sabotaging and hurting the economy of the country. Okay. Nigerian airlines will never grow. If Turkish airline tomorrow starts flying to Port Harcourt, from Port Harcourt they are flying to Abuja. They carry passengers from Port Harcourt. They drop in Abuja. Then from Abuja they go to their country. Where is this done? It should not be allowed. If they want Port Harcourt passengers, let them have an agreement with a local carrier. So all their Port Harcourt passengers will now fly through the local carrier. It doesn't have to be APs. Bring them to Abuja or Lagos, wherever they want to fly from. By so doing, revenue is going to the local side. And the local airlines are the ones providing the jobs. The foreign airlines, They just signed a JSA agreement with one company, and that is all. How many people did they employ?
Yeah.
APs are giving employment to over 4,000 people. All the airlines put together in 60 years of the operation have not even employed up to 1,000 people. I'm not talking about now. I mean, aggregate of whatever they must have employed in all their years of flying to Nigeria put together. So, if we want to grow our GDP, you have to give jobs to people. The way to give jobs to people is not to allow these foreign airlines ravage our country with impunity. Aviation will never grow. Quote me. Aviation will never grow if we continue allowing foreign airlines to dot every nook and cranny of our nation back to their own country. If you know the amount of foreign earning the airlines take out back to their country, for goodness sake, don't give me the reason that Nigerian passengers, if they work, is their comfort. That's why you now have to allow every airport in Nigeria. Some are having 5 destinations into Nigeria, some foreign airlines. You don't do that. It's like saying that you allow unrestricted importation of goods into Nigeria because Nigerians like imported goods. That is it. Because they can import water because they like everything foreign. It's like allowing them because, oh, that will give them comfort. It's the same reasons we hear about, people want it. No, it's not what people want because indirectly, it will hurt the economy and hurt the people. When there are no jobs, robbers and banditry will increase and they start killing people. Yeah. And our national reserve will start going down. We don't need it. We need to encourage Nigerian airlines. They need to be encouraged.
Your next destination
after Sharjah.
Johannesburg. We just got in their permit just yesterday after 3 years. Maybe because I went to see our Director General at NCA who queried them. Who was angry that why is it that up to this moment they've not answered their peace? So I thank Captain Muta. The African countries, they don't want you to come to their country. It's just like the single African air transport market is not working. It's lopsided against Nigeria. But Nigeria has a flying public, they don't have. All of them want to come and carry from Nigeria.
But they don't want us to come and take.
Yes, when you get to their country, they heap charges on you. And we'll never be able to do anything there. We've lost over 1 billion flying the West Coast. We just continue flying because we want to see if our government will help us to get these countries to create a level playing field. If not so, APs will soon go to court to start stopping some African airlines from coming into Nigeria until they create a level playing field for the indigenous airlines and our own from Nigeria.
Wow.
We must protect Nigeria.
Thank you so much, Allen. There's another video of Allen Onyema that I shot with him inside his first 777 when it landed Murtala Mohammed International Airport. Is a video that you all must see. In that video, he talked about every other thing that you'll be interested in knowing about the airline. It's actually the must watch for all of you. And also, I'll give you a sneak peek inside the Boeing 777-200, the one that'll be going to Sharjah very soon. It's really a beautiful aircraft. Thank you so much, Allen, and thank you all for watching. Please do not forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't subscribed. And for those of you that have subscribed, a big thank you to you. I appreciate all of you. Thank you so much once again, and bye-bye.